Welcome back, friends. So let us continue with our revision part in the subject of environment and ecology. So today we will be dealing with the acts, laws and regulatory bodies. Okay, so we will see about ethanol production, why it is in use, and New Zealand has brought one new law, that is a zero carbon law. Germany has brought one new act called as Climate Protection Act, and government has given e-flow norms to River Ganga. Later we will see about the Forest Rights Act, we will see about the Recycling of Ship Act in India, we will see about the Coastal Regulation Zone rules, okay, and there is another topic about the blue flag in this context, okay. We will see about the biodiversity management communities, and finally eco-sensitive zones. Ethanol production, we already seen that government has allowed M15 or M100. That is the 15% methanol blending, right? We have already covered about the biofuel policy. So what are different generations in there, right? So here, the recently Ministry of Environment has announced that mills will not be requiring no additional environment clearance for using the B-heavy molasses. Okay, so you know molasses is produced in the process of sugar production, right? So earlier, that particular mills has to support to get the permission under the environment impact assessment, but now that has been removed, right? What does it do? This increases the ethanol production and and aids in our national biofuel policy to reach to certain level in 2030. The next topic is about the New Zealand, which has brought the zero carbon law. So what does it say? To make the New Zealand to reduce greenhouse gases and become carbon neutral by 2050. And the bill requires all greenhouse gases except methane from the animals to be reduced to net zero by 2050. Remember, this is given as some leeway to farmers. Why? Because of the cattle is one of the significant contributors that produces the methane, right? In the forms of burps gas, right? And remember, methane has the greater potential than CO2 in the context of global warming. The next topic is about the Germany's Climate Protection Act. So they have brought this Climate Protection Act in an attempt to reach its targets, right? So we know that in Paris Agreement, each country has its own intended determined contribution, right? So what does that act say? So it making compulsory for the companies after 2021 to get the pollution rights. Which companies? The companies that are using the diesel and petrol, right? So they need the pollution rights to run those kind of companies. And it also added additional tax, right, in the aviation sector. Finally, so the reason why it is like to reduce the carbon emissions and impose their ban, is there is another feature that they are imposing certain kind of fees on the carbon emissions. See friends, we also have a similar kind of tax on the carbon emitting sector. For example, we have clean energy cells, which is taken on the coal, right? The next topic is about the e-flows norms for the River Ganga. So from December 2019, this has been, e-flow norms has been implemented by the National Mission for the Clean Ganga. So what is e-flow? That is the environment flow. What does it mean? It means that minimum amount of the flow that is necessary to preserve its ecosystem, that is including its flora and fauna, should be able to sustain, right? That is called as the e-flow or the environment flow. So according to that, the volumes in the in the related dams, barrages on the particular river will be managed. Some background information about the NMCG, that is the National Mission for the Clear Ganga. It is an apex body responsible for cleaning Ganga and rejuvenation of river, right? So this is an implementation of wing of the National Ganga Council. So this has replaced the National Ganga River Basin Authority. Please also remember that this authority, which is the earlier authority, has come under Environment Protection Act 1986, which has been replaced, right? And please do remember that the Ganga has been declared as the National River of India. The next topic is about the Forest Rights Act. This act was passed in December 2006. So what does it deal? It deals with the rights of forest dwelling communities, that is the tribal people, and how they manage their resources inside the forest, right? Because their sole life is dependent on the resources that are produced from the forest. So the act grants legal recognition, please remember, legal recognition to the rights of these traditional forest dwelling communities, partially correcting the injustice caused by the earlier forest acts. Remember friends, in the historical perspective, if we see the forest acts that have come in the British British times, they were very much discriminative towards these people, right? And please look at the inclusions or the exclusions or the exclusions of certain resource plants in this from this act, with respect to this act, because recently the government last year tried to remove the bamboo, but however the dependency of the tribals in the northeast on this bamboo is very much important, so they brought back this bamboo into this list. Okay, the next topic is about the Recycling of Ships Act. So we have already discussed about the Hong Kong International Convention that deals with the recycling of ships. What are the hazards coming from that? So in that particular line, even India has brought this Recycling of Ships Act, right? So what does it say? So it restricts the amount of the hazardous material that is producing by this process of recycling of ships, and that is in line with the Hong Kong International Convention. However, remember, please remember that those particular restrictions on the hazardous material that is producing is not applicable to the warships and the non-commercial ships that are operated by the government, right? The next topic is about the Coastal Regulation Zones rules. So recently, Supreme Court has ordered to demolish 59 villas in the Kerala which come under these zones. So first, what are those zones? These zones are being are the important ecosystem, fragile ecosystems, which are very much important for preserving the unique ecosystems, right? And any disturbance in these ecosystems will have a repercussive effects on the other environments as well. So these rules are made by the Union Environment Ministry, and it is implemented by the Coastal Zone Management Authority. So it restricts certain kind of activities, that is like the large constructions, industries in those particular areas, right? Please do remember there is one important community on CRZ, that is the Silas Nayak Committee, that has been established in 2014. So these rules were first notified under the Environment Protection Act 1986. The next topic is about the center itself easing the CRZ rules for the blue flag beaches. First of all, we need to look at what are the blue flag beaches, right? So these are the ecotourism model beaches which have the basic infrastructure like providing the healthy bathing facilities or amenities to the tourists. Okay, so these are those kind of ecotourism model based beaches. So this has started in France and later it has expanded to different countries. So under what criteria the particular beach is decided as the blue flag beach? So there are 33 such factors, like the quality standards, water quality standards, how the disposable facilities are available, is it disabled friendly, is there first aid equipment, so on. Remember that from India, Chandrabhaga Beach is the first such beach. And on the other hand, Japan and South Korea are the only countries in South and Southeast Asia to have these beaches, right? So coming to the current affairs, government has eased these rules No, to bring such blue flag beaches, right? So, biodiversity management committees. So, presently, this is in the news because the NGT is hearing up to what extent the Biodiversity Act 2002 is been implemented. Okay, so as per this act, so BMCs are created for the promotion, conservation, sustainable use, and documentation of biological diversity by the local bodies across the country. Okay, so these committees' composition is it shall have one chairperson and six other members, that is the maximum level. And remember, it has the sections from the vulnerable people, that is the women, which and that is they're providing like at least one third people from the women, and not less than 18% from the SC and ST category. So what are the functions, main function of this BMC? They prepare the people's biodiversity register in the consultation with the local people. Okay, eco-sensitive zones. Please do remember this does not mention in the this act, that is the Environment Protection Act. Generally, people tend to confuse this, but please do remember these are not mentioned. Then how the government is making rules about these eco-sensitive zones? They have taken two sections from this act and they come up with rules particular to this zones, right? So that is a section 3.2. So that can restrict the industrial or any kind of operations there, and they can completely prohibit, right, to preserve the local biodiversity. So by including these two sections, it has come up with these kind of areas. Remember, the same criteria has been used by the government to declare the no development zones. Okay, so please do share your feedback and continue with your preparation. Thank you.